Well, you know, I somehow always knew about some things. For one thing, when you are 4 years old, you begin to read numbers, right? You learn your numbers. And so I saw the numbers on my father's arm. So I remember quite distinctly asking him about them. What? Why do you have numbers on your arm? And he was very matter of fact about it. But my father made light of things, you know. He didn't want to trouble us, and he just laughed and said, "Oh, a blond man put them there." And when I said, "Did it hurt?" he just shrugged his shoulders. But my mother said that father had been in concentration camp. But you know, what does that mean? But there weren't grandparents. We had a very small family, and it was clear my parents spoke with an accent, with quite a pronounced accent, and my mother had terrible nightmares. She would cry out. And so we knew pretty quickly that they had a history. I'll tell you when my father started revealing more. In 1962, well, you know the history of, you know American history, surely, and the intensifying of the civil rights movement from the 1950s. Well, it began from the moment of enslavement. People were resisting. But following the Supreme Court decision to outlaw separate but equal in the United States, there was a movement. Well, there were several things that happened. One of the things that happened in the American South is that many of the white communities, rather than desegregate the schools, which is bring black students and white students together, simply closed public schools and created private schools for white children, which meant that black children were not continuing education. So the American Friends Service Committee, this Quaker organization, it's a movement pretty well known for its pacifism, organized families in the North in good school systems to host students who couldn't go to school in the South. So we had a student who stayed with us, Moses Scott, and he was 18 years old, we were 10 years old. But it was at that point that my father began to talk much more frankly about what had happened during the war, because he felt an immense affinity with Moses. For one thing, the reason our family was chosen to be a host family in 1962 was because my parents were very frank when they were asked what motivates them to have a black student in their home. They said, "Well, we survived Hitler. We are very acquainted with the consequence of racism, and this is the least we can do." Make some witness participate as actively as we know how to show that such notions of racial superiority are utter nonsense. So my parents were always activists, but I remember somebody came, a junior high school teacher came with his students to interview my father. And there I listened with wide eyes to his many stories. But his stories were inevitably very humorous because that's how he dealt with things. But it was, and then, you know, we knew my mother had a twin who died, who was killed under unhappy circumstances. And I don't know, somehow we always, it was always, there were shadows, you know. There are photographs. We were lucky enough to have photographs because my mother's aunt had gone to Brussels to be educated in the 30s when she couldn't be educated here in Poland. And we had photographs from an uncle who went to Palestine in the 30s, and even a letter from my grandmother. But here we have photographs, but no people living who are connected to these photographs. So there were stories instead. But so little by little, the story unfolds. And as I developed as a person, I wouldn't say I was inordinately obsessed, but I, with finding out what happened, but books came into my life. After all, I'm a librarian by profession myself, but what did Mother say? Mother, she said, "We were born to books," in her thick Polish accent. I remember her saying, "We were born to books."